Hello everyone, and welcome to Aspic AMR video podcast series. And as public health is one of our major concerns of outreach, this is the time we reach out to you with the experts' guidelines and information on COVID-19. And for this, we have brought you a series on COVID-19 and public engagement. This is the third episode of our series focusing on the mucormycosis, a fungal infection, which is gaining a lot of relevance during this COVID-19 pandemic. For this, we have with us Dr. Raksha Kebhat, who is the consultant and head of the microbiology department at St. Martha's Hospital. So let's go on and discuss with her the basic information and also clear all our doubts related to mucormycosis. So first of all, we are very happy to have you on this session, ma'am. Thank you for accepting our invitation.
Thank you. Thank you so much for calling me. Greetings from Martha's Hospital and eager to have this podcast. I hope that we can clarify a lot of doubts through this session. And yeah, we can start off. Thank you for calling.
Thank you, ma'am. Before moving on, I would like to just have a chit chat with you. So how is your Sunday going?
Yeah, see, Sundays are a kind of weekdays only now in the hospitals for us right now with the pandemic. It's been almost 1.5 years. With the first wave of COVID pandemic, we just had COVID cases to handle. But now, the topic as it's today, I've already started off mucormycosis. We are having a lot of secondary infections, secondary fungal infections, bacterial infections. Kind of. Now, the second wave, the cases are coming down, but the challenges what we are facing in the hospitals are quite different with regards to antimicrobial prescribing, fungal infections, critical care. So these are the challenges currently which we are having. So Sundays are no less busy.
So that's fine. So let's move on to our questions.
Yes.
So basically, what are fungal infections and what conditions like cause, predispose us to the fungal infections? And can you give us a brief note on that, with an Indian perspective?
See, when we talk about microbes per se, we know that there are bacteria, there are viruses, there are fungi, basic things what we have learned in biology, right? Like we humans, they are also a part of the environment. So when we talk about fungal infections per se, what is the common incidence or prevalence in the community as such? We don't see so many fungal infections regularly unless the host, that is the patient, that's the person who is coming to the hospital, is either immunocompromised. That means to say his immunity is low, which could be due to reasons such as say he or she is a cancer patient on chemotherapy, or a diabetic, or is on steroids for any reason, or is already undergoing some sort of therapy or having some sort of comorbidity. His health is already compromised. So usually per year, you would have around 6 to 10 cases of mucor. But now with COVID, we are seeing a sudden surge in India across the country, as we are seeing, right? So there's a lot of pathophysiology is what we call the interaction between the virus and the host, which is predisposing the patients to develop these sorts of fungal infections. So usually this is found in patients who are immunocompromised, like I already mentioned. So it's not very common, but with this recent surge, we are seeing it in a group of patients who are already affected by COVID and are recovering post-COVID who are developing these infections.
So what about the other fungal infections? Now we are just listening to mucormycosis. So there are other fungal infections which affect humans. So what about those in India, like previously, and how was the status of those disease before COVID or currently also, how is the status?
See, when we talk about fungal infections per se, like I already said, patients who are immunocompromised. Now, coming to the kind of infections, say you can classify this fungal infections into those which affect the skin, soft tissue, say a small ringworm infection that you get, starting from there to subcutaneous infections. All these infections, what you're seeing now, mucormycosis, aspergillus, these are all deep-seated infections. Unless the patient has an immune condition, looking at what kind of infections which were in common before COVID, just to cite a few infections, say Candida. Candida is one of those fungus. It's a yeast-like cell which causes, in patients who are admitted in the ICU, it can cause a sepsis, bloodstream infection, or a urinary tract infection. This is one of the common infections which we saw in patients, Candida. Then we have Aspergillus. Aspergillus is another fungus which causes, say, lung infections. So these were the common infections which we noticed initially, like, you know, in a hospital setting. Outside the hospital, you would have a small, skin infection or, you know, that's all. I mean, but now when you look at mucor is something which we saw one or two cases in a year, max. Maybe in a big hospital, it could be around, 6 to 10 cases in a year. So this was the spectrum in India. It was not like this before. Only in the last 2 months, we are facing this surge of mucor cases.
So can you describe to us the causal agent of mucormycosis and how the basic symptoms and infection would look like?
When it comes to mucormycosis, as the term says, mucor is one of the name in the list of fungi which can cause mucormycosis. Scientifically, there are about 10 to 12 fungi with different names which can cause mucormycosis, which colloquially now is called black fungus, isn't it? Now, mucormycosis, what happens is this fungal agent, this fungi, is generally present in the environment. If you keep your food outside, say, or your refrigerator is not working, you would see some black spores which are there on the bread or which we call as molds. Now, this is what is present outside. Now, what happens if a patient or a person, his immunity is low and he's already, say, diabetic or on high dose of steroids, this fungi is already present in the environment. He can inhale them. Once the fungi enters the respiratory tract, it starts colonizing inside. Now, since his immunity is low and the fungi is colonizing, what happens? One activity this fungi is known to cause is angioinvasion, which means to say it invades the blood vessel. So once it starts invading a blood vessel, it can enter any organ. So what could be the presentation for a patient who is having a mucor in the initial stages? He can develop, a blocked nose or a sense of heaviness in his sinuses. Or say if it affects the eye, his vision might be affected, or he or she might have a headache. Now, the critical part here is the time of reporting to the hospital. Why are we fearing mucormycosis? One thing is once it sets in, the infection sets in, the progression can be very fast. And the mortality rate is almost 50%. So a patient who has mucor infection can have all these signs and symptoms, say of a blocked nose or say a bleeding through a nose or some sort of discharge which is coming out through the nose, heaviness in the sinuses, vision might be affected, headache. Now all these are the signs and symptoms of something called as the rhinocerebral orbital mucormycosis. That means to say your sinuses, nose, eyes, the upper part of your respiratory tract is affected. Now, if the other organs are affected, not just this part, you can have a lung being affected, which is pulmonary mucormycosis. The skin can be affected, which is called again skin dermatological manifestation, or the kidneys might be affected. Basically, any organ can be affected by mucormycosis, not just these organs. So somebody who comes with these symptoms, these are the warning signs.
So basically, like, how do you diagnose if someone with these presentations or symptoms come to the hospital? How is it diagnosed, and what are all the general treatment measures that are prescribed for the patient?
Yeah. Now, talking about the diagnosis of mucormycosis, one thing is early identification. Thanks to these educational activities and the IEC materials that everybody is sharing around, people are aware that these cases are coming up, and somebody with risk factors or uncontrolled diabetes, high dose of steroids, or some sort of illness or immunocompromised condition, you need to know that you can be at a risk of developing this. That is one thing. Second thing, notice the early warning signs: headache, loss of vision, discharge coming through the nose, bleeding, heaviness in the cheek or head, having a headache. These are the clinical signs and symptoms. So you have your clinical features. Visit the doctor if you develop all these signs and symptoms. Second thing is radiological signs, which we can diagnose by taking a X-ray or a scan, CT scan, MRI scan, which your doctors will prescribe once you visit them. Third thing is taking the correct sample for testing in the lab, which is the microbiological diagnosis. So if somebody is having signs and symptoms of mucormycosis, what the doctor will do is refer you to an ENT surgeon, or maybe himself, take a sample of the tissue material or a high nasal swab. Usually the tissue material is preferred. So what we do is we take that tissue and send it to the lab. In the lab, what the lab does is this, there are two sections, which could be a microbiology and histopathology. What we do is we take this tissue material and we look for this fungi under the microscope. So what we do is this tissue is put under different stains. It could be a potassium hydroxide stain, or say calcifer white stain, or some staining which are called as gomori methanamine stain. So what we do is we try to look for this fungi under microscope. Technically speaking, these hyphae are called broad aseptate hyphae. They look like ribbons under the microscope. So we try to identify whether these are there or not. Try to grow this fungi. We culture them. So what we do is we culture them under the caused by fungi, or is it just a colonization? So once it starts growing, we know, okay, this is this particular species of mucor which is causing mucormycosis. So this report is necessary to call, okay, this infection is due to mucormycosis. So there are three components to the diagnosis. One is your clinical signs and symptoms, which the patient will come to the hospital with. Second thing is your X-ray or CT scan or MRI scan, which are the radiological tests which the doctor will ask. Third thing is your microbiological and histopathological diagnosis. In histopathology, we also do biopsies, so we can see how much the fungi is invading the tissue. Now, with this diagnosis, your doctor will decide what is the next line of treatment.
So as you were mentioning about various clinical manifestations and symptoms, what will be the basic treatment? Like, can it be just subsided with drugs, or are there any other things necessary for this to overcome the infection?
When we talk about the treatment of mucormycosis per se, there are two things important here. One is your surgical line of management, wherein the surgeons and the ENT people come into picture. And second thing is your medical line of management, wherein you use antifungal drugs. Now, when it comes to surgical therapy, first thing is, this is one thing we need to understand is, this is a life-saving surgery. Like I already mentioned, this fungus invades the tissue. So once it sets in, it will invade the blood vessels and it can reach various organs. It can cause a lot of complications. So basically what the surgeon will try to do is try to remove this fungus and the necrotic tissue which is already damaged. So maybe a patient who is already under a severe stage might require severe tissue debridement, what we call in technical terms, wherein 2 to 3 revision surgeries might be needed, wherein plastic surgeons have to come into picture and set right the damage that is already done, which could be a severe stage. But not all of us reach that stage. Initially, if you know these warning signs, we have had patients wherein we identified them at an early stage and not much of damage was done. So it depends on the stage of the disease in which the patient comes. So if it is in the initial stages with the small surgeries like what we call debridement, the mucus tissue which is already damaged can be removed. Minimal surgery is necessary, but surgery has to be done. This is your surgical line of management. This will be based on the scan reports. How much is the invasion? What all organs have been damaged? So surgical line of treatment is a must. Okay. Second is your medical line of management, wherein we are using some drugs called as antifungals. Now, what are the antifungals available? One thing is amphotericin B. Now, these are available in, this is available in two formats. One is liposomal amphotericin. Second is plain amphotericin. Now, liposomal amphotericin is preferred. Although this is what we call it is nephrotoxic. That means to say it affects the kidney. But these drugs, one thing is they are very costly, but they are needed. This is the only line of therapy. It might go on to 6 to 12 weeks for treatment. So also what happens is if it is not given at the right time, only surgery might not be enough. So either liposomal amphotericin B, if it is not available, which is what we are facing now, an acute shortage of this antifungal, plain amphotericin B can be used. There are other antifungals called as posaconazole, isavuconazole. All these antifungals can be used, but the duration of therapy is quite long. It can be almost 6 to 12 weeks. So these are the two lines of management for mucormycosis.
But as you are telling, is surgery like essential, or if patients initially can observe themselves and recognize the early warning symptoms and come to the hospital very quickly or approach a doctor very quickly, then only with the medicines like amphotericin and or other antifungal agents, will it be enough, or they also are required to go for surgical interventions?
See, one thing is this fungi is quite invasive. Once we do a microscopy test and see, okay, mucor is present, and then we do, say, a X-ray of the sinuses and see, okay, mucor is there, but how much is it invading? How much damage has already been done? We look at that, and the ENT surgeon decides how much of surgery to be done. Maybe a little mucosal tissue invaded. Okay, we can only scrape out that tissue and say we'll watch out for further progression. But what happens is this fungi doesn't give us so much time. Like I said, it's progressing very fast. So early signs and symptoms, if you identify, the minimum possible surgery would be maybe a sinus examination and debridement of the mucosal tissue. But sadly, we are not seeing patients in that early stage. We are seeing patients who have already lost their vision or have some sort of bleeding through the nose. So that's why we are trying to tell patients, come to the hospital early when you have early warning signs. It can progress within a matter of 2 to 3 days, and it can be quite bad for patients. In a matter of week, we have seen patients even lose life. So early warning signs, it's a must to for the patients to identify.
Also, considering early warning signs are very important. Also, highlighting a point that amphotericin is like the drug with side effects, so it's not advised for people to consume as such without consulting a doctor.
Always under prescription, and also to watch out for the sugar levels, uncontrolled diabetes, high use of steroids. See, steroids are something which are not to be taken over the counter. once a doctor prescribes, there is a regimen. That means to say they need to be tapered. Many of these patients who are coming are on a high dose of steroids for weeks without being monitored, and sugar levels which are quite high. So these are the two risk factors which we are commonly seeing in mucormycosis cases. The other issues which we are getting around to, like hear from patients, is it from the oxygen mask? Is it from the hospital, from patient to patient? One thing I would like to clarify is mucor doesn't spread from patient to patient. Second thing is oxygen mask and your regular mask, what you are using. Of course, you have to maintain the sterility. That means to say, ensure that whatever mask that you are using is cleaned, especially the cloth mask, which if you're continuously using, ensure that you're washing it with hot water and soap. And if you're using disposable masks, there are people who are using the N95 mask for days. They're already black outside. So you ensure that they are disposed of in a correct way. Don't use it over and above the prescribed duration. So these fungi, what happens is once you wear a mask, the humidity can set in inside. So it can colonize and it can invade the sinuses. So a good level of hygiene, respiratory hygiene, is important. Controlling your sugars, controlling your medications under doctor's guidance. So all this is important post-COVID.
So just deviating a little bit from the topic, I would just like to ask, like, as you are telling, antifungal drugs are given for this infection. Have you ever come across any case that won't work, like that won't respond for the antifungals that are being given? And if it, like, is there any form of resistance, as we can see in like bacterial infections, antibiotic resistance? Is there any form of antifungal resistance with respect to mucormycosis, or also in general?
See, when we talk about antifungal resistance, as such, antibiotics, when we talk about, they, we see that a lot of antibiotic resistant strains are being found and all that. But when it comes to antifungal, we don't prescribe antifungals that routinely, unless, say, it's a candida infection or an aspergillus infection. But here, for us, the important thing is to know what species of the fungi is causing infection. Some of them are inherently resistant to these antifungals. The common antifungals which we use are, say, amphotericin B, azoles, fluconazole, voriconazole, all these azoles, which we are commonly prescribing for candida. We need to know the species of candida which it is for which we are prescribing these antifungals. They can be inherently resistant. Of course, when we misuse these antifungals, there is a chance of these fungi developing resistance to this. Now, with the current surge in cases, there is high probability of people misusing this. So I would like to stress on the fact that don't take these antifungals unless it is prescribed by the doctors for you. It has no preventive role. So taking these antifungals will not prevent fungal infections. It has to be under a doctor's prescription.
Yeah, that should be stressed more, because people might think, like, if they take it earlier, they might
yes.
not contract disease or infection in future times. So also, we are listening a lot on other fungal infections that are coming up, like with the names of yellow fungus or white fungus. So what about these things? Can you just briefly tell us about these infections?
Yeah, so just on a lighter note, we have had about three colors now. Black fungus, white fungus, yellow fungus. So like the colors of the rainbow, no? We were waiting for the other colors. When is blue going to come, green going to come, red going to come? So just adding a scientific point of view to this. See, when we talk about black fungus as such, what does this black mean? In terms of mucormycosis, what is this mucor doing? It's damaging the tissue. So the tissue becomes necrotic because the blood vessels are being damaged. So that when the tissue becomes necrotic, the tissue becomes black in color. So if you would have seen pictures where patients are having mucormycosis, having a scab over the face or a disfigured face, which is black in color, right? So that's why media started coining this term as black fungus. So when this infection is at some other site and there's some sort of discharge coming out, say some pustular discharge is coming out, which is in like, you know, in the color of white, then they started calling it white fungus. When the pus was like yellow in color, they started calling it yellow fungus. Now, this has nothing to do with the fungus per se. It's just the clinical feature. So there's nothing termed as black, yellow, or white in fungi, unless microbiologists or scientists who are working on it and know the species. This black fungus technically in microbiology is for some other species, which is due to the presence of melanin in the fungus. Melanin is something like, say, our hair or skin, where we have this pigment. If that melanin pigment is present, we call that fungi black fungi, which is completely different from mucormycosis. So they're all different fungi species. So there's nothing called as black fungus in terms of mucormycosis. It's just the clinical presentation. Now, white and yellow fungus also, by terms of media, could be the same mucormycosis presenting in the same way, just that the discharge was yellow or white in color. One common misconception which people had was, oh, white fungus could be candida, yellow fungus could be aspergillus. Now see, these are all different species of fungus which cause different infections. So candida usually causes an oral thrush. There's a white patch inside the mouth, or say it could be a vaginal candidiasis, which is a genital infection where the discharge is white. So these are all misconceptions. There are two things to this. The context to which it is being told to the general public through newspapers or social media. So a fear sets in, a kind of panic sets in. Once you know these terminologies, the scientific terminologies, there is clarity. I don't think there should be any reason to fear. If you can identify the early warning signs and come to the doctor as soon as these signs and symptoms develop. So there is treatment to this. It is not that, you know, there are more fungi to come. There is no red or yellow, like, you know, blue, green, no fungi like that.
What happened, like the description started changing. One day it was reported as black fungus and there's other kind of manifestations and it was white, yellow. So people started thinking like there might other colors are yet to come. So that was
misconceptions.
So, yeah. So one more very important question is, all of a sudden, why we are seeing so much cases of mucormycosis? Like, is it something related to COVID-19 or is it due to the therapy or the drugs which we are taking to overcome for COVID-19, is it causing mucormycosis? As you were already mentioning that the usage of steroids and the high level of glucose are predisposing for fungal infections. So can you talk a little bit more on that?
See, when we are talking about the sudden surge of mucor cases now, why is it so? There are many aspects to this. One thing is, the kind of patients which you are seeing with mucormycosis, these are the people who had COVID in the past, which was, say, 2 to 3 months ago. And they are coming to the hospital now with these signs and symptoms. When we look at their history, what has happened, the risk factors, what we have seen is uncontrolled diabetes, like I already mentioned, high dose of steroids. These are two important factors which we have seen. The steroid prescriptions have been quite rampant, not monitored. So these are the two factors which we have commonly seen. Second thing is the kind of environments that they live in, the masks that have been used, the respiratory hygiene. Third thing is inside the hospital, once they get admitted, they can be there in the hospital for a prolonged duration. So the kind of infection control practices in the hospital, whether the oxygen masks, the cannula, the sterilization precautions that have been followed in the hospital, whether they were adequate. Now, all these risk factors have contributed to this sudden surge of cases. Now, why COVID cases? We have had cancer patients before. We have had immunocompromised patients, diabetic patients before. Why suddenly with COVID? Now, all these factors together, it's not just one, have contributed together to add to this spectrum. Now, as we all know, India is a diabetic capital of the world. We have a high load of diabetic patients in this country. Second thing, COVID. Now, what we have heard various theories with COVID is it has a special predilection to ACE2 receptors, which we already know. There are various theories going around with the current scientific literature. What is being cited is it can affect the pancreas. COVID-2 affects the ACE2 receptor. So it has some correlation with sudden surge in diabetes also. So, and steroids. Now, all these factors interact together, and that's why this sudden surge in mucor cases. So, I hope that answers the question. Why with COVID cases, sudden rise in mucor mycosis?
So, it's better to avoid TPAX without the consulting doctors, taking steroids or prophylaxis in order to avoid contracting disease in future. People might consider that, because if they get in contact with some person whom they hear he or she became positive, then they just start consuming the drugs which were given to that person just by taking the list from WhatsApp. So that has become very much more. So if people can avoid that and just consult doctor as quickly as possible whenever you feel you have some infection or you have some symptoms, that would avoid all the further complications very much.
Yes.
And also stressing one more point, like you were telling, this mucor mycosis is not communicable, like it will not spread from person to person. Like if we have a person who is infected in our home or somewhere, so what care should be taken by others who are just assisting him or her on the course of recovery?
As I already mentioned, mucor doesn't spread from person to person. If a person is already affected with COVID, post-COVID, and has developed mucor, he would definitely seek hospital care. He would undergo some sort of surgical line of therapy and medical management. One thing is post-recovery for mucor mycosis, the focus should be on the wound care. How much of tissue damage has been done and how much of surgery has been done for the patient. He or she might require multiple revision surgeries depending on the area that is involved. Most commonly, we are seeing the face being involved. So, a lot of surgical procedures might be needed. So, definitely, it is something which can be psychologically taxing for the patient. So, a lot of family support and all that is needed for the patient. Second thing is the wound care. Maintain a good level of hygiene. And if possible, ensure that the dressings are being done frequently as per the doctor's advice. Any sort of, during the course of recovery, if there is any sort of new discharge coming, new symptoms and symptoms, please report to the doctor again. Third thing is don't panic. There are a lot of patients who have lost their vision, lost their eye, have got undergone disfigurement of the face, who have recovered and who have recovered very well. A lot of plastic surgeons and neurosurgeons are helping patients to recover. And see, basically, we are trying to save a life here. With even 50% mortality rate, we are having patients who are recovering. So the stressing on the fact again, early warning signs. Earlier you report, the lesser the tissue damage, so better the recovery chance. So infection control, not just in the hospital, even in your house, when the patient is at home, ensure that the wound care, the personal hygiene, diet, everything is taken care of as per the doctor's advice, and maintain the medications, the steroids, the diabetes control, everything has to be under the doctor's prescription.
So, collectively, you have told many things which have to be taken care of. But even then, people are fearful. Like if they are already once COVID positive, listening to this mucormycosis infection, they are having fear that they might also get the infection. So finally, can you just elaborate on the fact that like what care should be taken by a COVID positive, like who is recovered and who has got a negative report once? So will he be more prone to mucormycosis, or what care he or she has to take in order to just be safe?
See, now what has happened is officially mucormycosis is considered as a notifiable disease under our government's Epidemiological Disease Act, which has been now brought upon by the various state governments, saying that any kind of mucormycosis case which is being reported in the hospital has to be notified by the government. There's a lot of support from the government and private hospitals also regarding early identification of these cases. So no need to panic. All the doctors and nurses in the hospital are aware of these cases that are coming up. And also from the patient side, like I already mentioned, know your early warning signs. If you are recovered from COVID and during the course of recovery, say about 2 to 3 months down the lane after the COVID recovery has set in, watch out for these signs and symptoms. Heaviness in the cheeks, some sort of blocked nose, loss of vision, headache. Now, these are the signs and symptoms which a patient can develop. Please come and visit the doctor if you have these signs and symptoms developing post-COVID. Your doctor will look into it, examine your ear, nose, throat, and see if this requires any sort of investigations further. Some x-ray scans, any microbiological tests. So if these are done at the right time, when you come to the doctor at the right time, things can be handled well. Only if the disease progresses more, then we go into surgical line of management. So no need to fear unless it goes into that stage. So watch out for these signs and symptoms for the 3 or 4 months post COVID recovery. And it's not that everybody who has got COVID is going to develop this disease. There has to be some risk factors. Say diabetes is uncontrolled, steroid usage is rampant, not being controlled. So only those patients who have not been monitored in those lines can get into mucormycosis. Not all patients get into mucormycosis post COVID. So I think that would sum that up.
So I think we have sufficiently covered most of the points, and with the take-home message of not getting frightened so that you may get mucormycosis because you had COVID or because it's just being reported in news or something else. Just watch out for the signs and symptoms and follow personal hygiene. And also when you are considering any of the medications that are related to COVID, or in general also, it's very wrong to self-medicate yourself without contacting or without getting suggestions from a qualified doctor. So with this, I would just like to ask you, ma'am, what will be your message for all of us who are listening to this podcast, like generally in this tough times we are undergoing?
One thing is this COVID pandemic is, there's nothing like a beginning or end of this. COVID is one virus. We have a lot of microbes going around. We also have the problem of antimicrobial resistance, which we are all aware of, which is another silent pandemic which is going on. A lot of viruses and bacteria are going to come, but the fear should be there. But it has to be a good fear. What to do, what not to do, and everything has to be under supervision of healthcare professionals. A lot of things which go around in the media, self-prescriptions, then a lot of things which in relation to, say, new variants of COVID and all that, a lot of news comes. So when you get some information, always verify the authenticity of this information, especially when you are sharing it on social media. And get in touch with your doctors for any sort of therapy or treatment for any doubts. With regards to antimicrobial resistance, what I would want to add is, of course, mucor cases we are seeing. A lot of multi-drug resistant pathogens also we are seeing, which is not being reported in many hospitals. We are having multi-drug resistant acinetobacters, multi-drug resistant klebsiellas, which are causing pneumonias, say a ventilator-associated pneumonia in patients who are admitted in the ICUs. See, many of us, 80% of us are recovering from COVID. Another 15 to 20% of them are in the ICUs who are battling this pandemic for months together. Now, these are the patients who are being affected with this antimicrobial resistance. So don't forget your other pathogens as well. Also, problems like tuberculosis. Many of us are not coming to the hospital despite having cough and all sorts of symptoms which are pointing towards tuberculosis. Any sort of illness, COVID or otherwise, please visit your doctor and seek hospital care. Don't have the fear that, oh, COVID cases are going on, let's not go to the hospital right now. No, please seek healthcare, be it whatever illness that you are having. So that is one point which I wanted to stress on. We are all forgetting the other infections which we are dealing with right now.
So definitely, yes, ma'am. But there are also other sort of things, like we can also connect to doctors via Zoom or online,
yes,
things that are also very much more. So there is no need to just give that reason of the surge in COVID, that reason as not going to hospital or not going to clinics. So thank you very much, ma'am. It was very nice having a conversation with you. And I hope all of us are aware of this infection and the information what we discussed so far. And we will definitely come out of what we are going now. And so we will just follow the COVID appropriate behaviors as prescribed by the government. Always wear mask whenever you go outside. Please follow double masking. And also sanitize your hands frequently or wash your hands with soap and water. And always maintain physical distancing, avoiding crowds. So thank you very much.